Good evening, everyone. I welcome you all to the webinar series of Bombay Naturalistic Society. Since lockdown condition, we are conducting various webinars, especially for the general public, to make them aware about the conservation efforts we are doing and to make people more aware about the various aspects of nature, biodiversity, and conservation in general. So about BNHS, the Bombay Naturalistic Society is 137 years young organization. It is a pan-India wildlife research organization and has been promoting cause of conservation since 1883. Our mission is conservation of nature, primarily biological diversity, through action-based research, education, and public awareness. So as our mission says, education and public awareness, so this particular program is for education and public awareness. So we have two different departments, Conservation Education Center and NVIS resource partner for avian ecology. So in collaboration with these two departments, we are presenting today's webinar. And next slide, please. So just we know a little bit about our Conservation Education Center. So our Conservation Education Center is placed in Goregaon, Mumbai, and we conduct various conservation education activities in the center. And you can see the contact details of CEC over the second slide, and you can communicate with them if you have any queries or you want to participate in any program. So next slide, please. So this is about environmental information system. BNHS is a resource partner with the Ministry of Environment and Forest on avian ecology. So our avian NVIS resource partner center was established in 1996, which is supported by Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, Government of India. And since our inception, our focus is basically to provide information to decision makers, policy makers, scientists, engineers, research workers, and etc. all over the country. And we have some objectives of creating a database on birds and related areas. We also publish Buceros newsletter. It's a quarterly newsletter. We have a data bank on various aspects of avian ecology. And we are spreading information on birds through various services. We also organize workshops and other things. And we also conduct green skill development programs, and the interested participant, especially the youth, can join this GSDP program in coming year. So this is about the environmental information system. Next slide, please. And here we go about the weaver birds in general and fin weaver in special. So I'm going to introduce to Dr. Rajat Bhargava. He's a senior ornithologist with the Bombay Naturalistic Society. He has more than 25 years of experience studying birds, various aspects of bird life. He's a former aviculturist also. And his specialty is weaver birds. And to give some more information. So in India, there are hardly few people who have worked on weaver birds. The first pioneer was Dr. Salim Ali. He worked on weaver birds throughout his life, and his first student, Dr. Vijay Kumar Ambedkar, who studied different weaver birds and especially the Finns weaver with Dr. Salim Ali. And we are very proud that Dr. Rajat Bhargav is following the footsteps of Dr. Ambedkar and Dr. Salim Ali, and he is also studying weaver birds since last 20 years, I would say. And he has recently published his report on Finns weaver. So now I hand over to Dr. Rajat Bhargav and request him to start his interesting webinar. Thank you,
Girish, for the lovely introduction of the bird about Salim Ali and Ambedkar Saab. I'd like to dedicate this lecture to Dr. V.C. Ambedkar, who is no more with us since last 2 years, the 3rd June. Is also the partner of BirdLife International. And BirdLife International, as many of you will be aware, is the authority on world birds. And every 3 years, 4 years, you know, they published State of World Birds. I was there for the release in Belgium. And when I saw the figures of presentation by those people, how they put it, it was very, very alarming. Most of you will know we have nearly, you know, less than 11,000 species between 10,500 and 11,000. Out of these, if you see, 222 species are critically endangered. This data you can get from the net. But, you know, when you see one out of eight species is among the threatened list of birds, and that is very alarming. And even if we have, you know, many people working on different species, still we will have very little to know about our birds, how they're vanishing. And this is one species which I've been working very, very close to my heart, and I'll talk about it. And as I say, State of World Bird, recently we had a release of State of India's Bird, when many organizations joined together. Swale was there, and BNHS, and WHO, everybody was there. And this report was released at the recent CMS COP in February in Gujarat. And, you know, even these figures are very alarming. Out of 1,100 species, out of nearly 1,300 species, slightly more than 1,300 species, 867 species are, you know, accessed in this report. And out of 10 lakh observations, you know, 52% show clear decline. So this is all very alarming. Vultures, everybody knows. But then there are very neglected species like fin weaver, which I'll be talking. Out of the 1,300 species, which I said, most of you will be alarmed again, and you're surprised to know, every year the numbers are increasing of the threatened list. Last year, evaluation said 180 species are threatened in India. So do we have 180 researchers working on these 180 species in India to know why they are getting extinct? So this is one example of how species are going. And, you know, when the State of India's Bird came, I really fought off for the species. You know why? When I said 10 lakh observations went to produce that report, there was hardly any observation, any sighting of the fin weaver. So 15,000 people were working for this in terms of contributing data, but nobody was looking at the species. Last year, a friend of mine, Vivek Menon, he came on the global bird day, says, please show me this species. I've been in Kaziranga many times. I have not seen this species. And then, you know, I was laughingly said, if I can't show you the species, who else will show you? So this species was probably a neglected species of India. This came in the State of India's Bird. And I'll talk as a storyline, you know, about the species, how I thought of, you know, started working on the species. See, Africa has got maximum number of weaver birds in the world, 124 species. In India, we have 4 species of weaver birds. I think every child, every old person would have seen sometime or the other, you know, nest, very nicely made nest like these hanging throughout the country. You know, this is the Baya weaver. All the weaver birds are excellent nest weavers. You know, in classes, we are taught class 5th, tailor bird, weaver bird. How many people have seen tailor bird nest, that is? But I'm sure most of you would have seen hanging nest. This is the time, you know, I was traveling with my director, Dr. Girish, everybody, we were traveling, Deepak Apte, and we were in Teshpur University. I saw, you know, the habitat was like Tarai, and it was in May. And I said, we must start our weaver bird count. See, we talk of house sparrow decline. I said, see, so many species are declining, and we started as BNHS, you know, the weaver bird counting. It was very, very successful. And many common species of weaver, you know, also, you know, through those reports came to be declining. I'll talk briefly about the, you know, introduce all these species before I come to the fin weaver. See, weaver birds have got a specialty. You know, throughout the year, you will see them in flocks, and they are very, very large flocks. They're very gregarious in nature. They'll keep fighting with each other. But the first picture which you see, this picture I took in the best fin weaver area where Dr. Salim Ali had visited in 1954, 1959. And from 1959 till 61, Dr. Ambedkar was working on the species. I took this picture nearly 25 years back, as Girish said. And, you know, in this flock of 2,000 birds, which I just, you know, saw it in a crop field before I took my camera, they were landing. Many birds have landed down in the, you know, in the grass, in the seeds they were eating. And if you see the down picture, it is in the non-breeding plumage. I will like to clarify here only. You know, most farmers in India think weaver birds are pests. I am sorry to say that I really differ. No weaver birds are pests because, you know, I work with the many trapping communities. I'll come to that part. I work with many people who are very close to nature. And when I was talking to these communities, why weaver birds are present in certain crop fields and why they're not found in the other crop fields. And they have a very simple answer. He says, in the last picture, the down picture, can you see most of the weaver birds are, you know, feeding on the grass weeds. And you talk of organic farming. If there are so many weedicides, so many pesticides, it's not organic. So birds visit in the fields which have got these weeds, and they 90% feed on the weeds, which is, you know, very common weed. It is called gulli danda, it is called ghiusa. They're all grass seeds, kodu, sama, and all these kind of things. So these birds come in big flocks to feed on the weeds, if you can see from the pictures. And they're gregarious throughout the years. Not only they feed on the weeds, maximum time I've seen these weaver birds feeding on the insects. If these birds are there, they help the farmer in eradicating the weeds, they help the farmers in eradicating the insects. So they are really farmed, they are farmer's friend, not pest as many people think. Okay. Now I'll come to the main four species. See, we all the time talk of, you know, foreign books or foreign publications, but you know, sometimes I really feel working for 25, 30 years with these communities, how beautiful names they had, which made me, you know, more interested. This is called the black-breasted weaver bird. It is also called the black-throated weaver bird. But it has got a very, very interesting name in Hindi in India by the trappers. This is called the Momia Choch Kapaya. Can you see the beak of the male? It is just like wax. It is like, you know, wax. So that name always remind me of, you know, Momia Choch Kapaya in Hindi. And this is also called the black-throated. And, you know, I'll come to the fin weaver. But if I have to talk of, you know, the other three species of weaver birds, as I said, four in the beginning, they have a distinctive breeding plumage. If you see the female on the left of you and right of mine, it is very drab color. You'll be surprised to know for 6 months, the male also becomes like the female, the drab in color. It's only during the breeding season, which starts in April onwards, they start acquiring the breeding plumage, which remains. And you know, isko hum log chand tara bhi kehte hain because of the yellow. So this is the local name. Among the four species of weaver birds in India, this is the most common. This is found throughout India. And you know, recently, you know, around one decade back, there was a very interesting paper which came from Ashish Pitti and, you know, S. Subramaniam. He's in Bangalore. He was in, you know, BirdLife. He was, you know, seeing these specimens and he saw the white-throated specimens in their collection. They wrote to us. And the same white collections were in Ikrisset in Hyderabad. So probably it is a different subspecies. We don't know. We have not done genetic work on it. But then it is also, you know, there are three variations, the black throat, the white throat, and slightly, you know, mixed throat in some. Then they intermingle in some places. And then this is the commonest baya. This is called the baya. You know, India has many folklore on the baya. You know, in the rainy season, they said a baya was observing a monkey. And she says, see, you are such a big animal. Why don't you make a you know, house for yourself? You are in the rain. And the monkey got so terrified that it plucked the nest of the weaver bird. And from that time onwards, the folklore says, not science says, most weaver birds make it over the water hole. They make it on very, very spiky, you know, the you know, spines with the kate, because so the, you know, the predators can't come. So this baya is found throughout India. It is also in some parts of Asia, and it has got three subspecies. One is the eastern baya, and one is the trunkover baya, which is found in South India. And this picture which I am showing is of the baya weaver in the North India. And again, like the black-breasted weaver bird, it acquires a non-breeding plumage. It becomes like the female. In the breeding time, they get the black beak, they get the yellow shining. And, you know, just for mature people to identify, except for the fin weaver, all weaver birds have got black throat or brown throat in the breeding time. That is a good identification mark. Okay. And you can see the female, which is very drab, and the juveniles are like the female when they are born, when they manage. And okay, then I'll come to the I'll come to the next slide here. This is the Street Weaver bird. This also has got a beautiful, you know, I forgot to tell you the local name of the earlier baya. It's called the Desi baya. It's very, very Indianized, and that is the reason many, many stories. This bird, the third species, is called the Street Weaver. And Hindi has got a beautiful name, Jalidar baya. If you can see the net in front of the breast. This is probably the second species after the fin weaver, which is getting almost declined everywhere. You know, I told you the first uses sacrum, you know, that chatai grass everywhere. The baya weaver uses scrub, thorny areas near crop fields. And this particular species, the street weaver bird, uses wet, tall grasslands. This needs, you know, tall wetlands, wet grasses standing in water. And the decline of the tall wet grasslands is also declining this bird. This is a real indicator of this. And you know, in last 4 years, I have not seen a colony. And it came in the newspaper, and then, you know, one farmer called me. He had 50 birds. He says, "Mere yahan bahut birds hai," and I happen to see this bird. So this is one species we should watch after the fin weaver. Okay. Now I introduce, you know, my fin weaver, my favorite species. I did not tell you the sizes of the bird. The first black-throated weaver bird is 14 centimeters. If you talk of the baya, it is, you know, 15. And the streak is also in between, you know, baya and that, around 15. Okay. Unfortunately, in the description given in by Dr. Salim Ali in handbook, in Birds of the World, which has copied Salim Ali book, the size is given 15 centimeter. But when I was talking of local names, you know, fin baya, or it's also called the yellow weaver, has got a very beautiful name because of the size, called bada baya. So the name itself, by the trappers who knew this species, who brought it to Salim Ali also, the size is very important. And it is also called the pahari baya because it is found below the hills. It is also called pahari baya or the bada baya. And this, I forgot to tell you, I'll tell you in the next slides. It is the only species in India where the females also acquire a breeding plumage, unlike the three other weaver bird species. So that is so different compared to the other three species. And it is 17 centimeters, it is bigger. Now I come to the status. This is probably the world rarest weaver bird. The first paper it got published said the discovery of fin weaver in Kumau Terai. That story I'll tell you. And you know, it was, you know, we didn't tell you in the beginning. We said 180 species are threatened. We said 1300 species are found in India. We never told you in the beginning that out of the 1300 species, there are 79 species which are found nowhere else in the world. And that is how the story of conservation began in Benaches of this bird. If 79 species are found nowhere else in the world, we as Indian ornithologists have to take care of it. Out of these 79 species, 35 species are in the threatened list. So as a policy of Benaches, I told Director Girish was there with me, we all said Benaches priority will be to work on threatened endemic species of India, which the whole population is in India. And you'll be surprised, fin weaver for 130 years was only found in India, nowhere else. And we, you know, did not set eyes except for Dr. Salim Ali and all. It was listed in 1988 as threatened, vulnerable in 1994. And when I said Nepal critically endangered, I'll come to the story. In India, I am sorry to say, despite so many organizations working for birds, it is still waited to be uplifted as endangered or critically endangered. I'll come to the story. You have to remind me if I forget it. And you know, global threatened species, there is a big criteria. People sitting in UK, based on our research, they mount our research, they work on it, and you know, very nicely, and then they declare it is a vulnerable, threatened, near threatened, or something, you know, endangered. So we have to work very closely with those people to make, you know, these threat categories, which really matters. Okay. Now I'll come to the distribution. Earlier I said the species was found in India. Now it is also found 50 kilometers from India in Nepal, in a place called Shukla Phata. In India, it is found only in 4 states, which is used to be UP, now Uttarakhand also, West Bengal and Assam. So the global population of the species was known only from 4 states of India. West Bengal, the population is extinct. Okay. So when I say extinct, I come to the scientific angle for the common masses to understand. See, if I say Tarai of Uttarakhand and UP, it was one state carved into Uttarakhand in 2000. That was one population called Apollosius Megarincus Megarincus. Okay, the bigger bill sizes is, and the eastern population is found in West Bengal and Assam. If West Bengal population is gone, we have done no genetics work. The world only subspecies population of eastern Finbaya remains in Assam, only in Kaziranga, one or two specimens seen in Manas. So the global population, see, tiger, you can see in so many places, in zoos, in parks, in sanctuaries, everybody is crying for tiger. But if there is really a subspecies, it is only in Assam, in Kaziranga. How many people go as a birder to see this species? Earlier, I told you about Vivek, a very good friend. He goes to Assam, Kaziranga. His, you know, work was in rhino, elephants. He said, I have never seen it for years. So if Assam, Kaziranga has got such a big, beautifully preserved area as a sanctuary, as a national park, why the species is not increasing? That will come in the end. I'll talk about the problems. And, you know, bird life says it is 10,000 individuals. They say something between 2,500. Okay, if the worst scenario says 2,500, it is less than the tiger. Everybody talks of the tiger. Nobody talks of these lesser known species. That is my question. I want to share a story. This bird is known to science for 151 years by A.O. Yum, who got two specimens. I told you in the beginning that they have winter plumage called the non-breeding plumage or the eclipse plumage. They have the breeding plumage when they turn yellow. So when A.O. Yum got these two specimens, they were in winter plumage. They probably could be two males. They probably could be two females. They could be a pair. Nobody knew except for this in December 86. Okay. He gave the name, seeing the larger bill, if you can see in the picture, how big is the bill in proportion to the head? It is half the size, and it is called because of this resembling, you know, the weight. And, you know, in Greek, great means large. The bill is the name. So the name comes from this. Okay. Now, it's a very, very interesting history. As I said, it was found, said to be found from Kaladungi in Nainital. Nainital that time had Kaladungi, Nainital, that time at Haldwani, it had many, many places. It's what called Nainital district. So nobody exactly knew where the birds came. It was said to be Kaladungi. Now I come to my role, and you know how, you know, I said it is an endemic species and it is called Frank Finn, or it's called Finn Weaver by a fauner. So what were we doing? You know how this name came? Because the superintendent of Calcutta Museum called Frank Finn, he purchased two birds from Calcutta Bird Market in 1901, after 1866. And the person who supplied his bird was a famous bird dealer called Ruthley. He says, sir, don't kill these birds because these birds are yellow and they will change color. In my 45 years of experience, I have not seen this bird. So this is so rare. So Frank Finn kept those birds, and Frank Finn saw the non-breeding plumage after almost 4 or 5 months. And that is how it is called Frank Finn. I'll show you the picture. And you know, then there were eastern population, Colonel O'Donnell in Hashimara, Jalpaiguri, and there was a big debate. But that was probably not the subspecies or true subspecies or a weaver bird, but the fin weaver. That was all debated. Surprisingly, nobody has seen this bird in the wild. And birds kept appearing in the market. Calcutta market, Salim Ali's cousin, Abdul Ali Saab, was a very good person. He used to go to the markets, used to work on, you know, morphology and many things. From 1901 birds in Calcutta market to birds in Calcutta market and in Crawford market in Mumbai, birds kept appearing, which Abdul Ali Saab got it. They are still in the Binich's collection. If you see the first plate, the black and white, not the black and white, the yellow, that was a painting which came in 1901. And Frank Finn named this bird as Apollosius Ruthley, based on the trader. And then he realized on the publication of Yum, just that one three-line short note, the name, that probably this bird is the same which Yum was talking. And these were the, you know, the traditional pictures of birds in traded. Can you see the size of the bill in the black and white pictures? So this was 1901 picture. Okay. Now comes to Salim Ali. Now comes to Binich's. Salim Ali was a leading ornithologist. He used to study birds. and he had sleepless nights about the species. He says, how a bird coming in the Indian bird markets is not known to science and it has not been seen by anyone in the wild. So the whole crux of the story is it was known to trappers. It was known to come in the trade, but not known to scientists. And I'll say my role, how it come after this slide. Before I say, Salim Ali from Mumbai led an expedition to Kala Dungi in 1934. Okay? He could not discover any bird. Kala Dungi was slightly a misnomer because that has more of forest patches. So the locality, type locality, was slightly wrongly described. And that is when you find a specimen, how nicely, how legislatively you should write the locality, because that fails, the search fails, like, you know, the forest audit and many things. After 34, Salim Ali went with another very great person, Alexander, to find this bird in 1953. Again, it was a fruitless search. They could not see the bird. Again, in 1959, the John Hurrell Crook was a world authority on weaver birds. He had come to India. He said, I also want to see it. And you know how this bird was found? The local trappers, the Pradami trappers, or the, you know, the Burji trappers, they told Salim Ali the first time that this bird is in Rampur and it is a Bada Baya. It is called Pahari Baya. And Salim Ali felt really very nice that at least somebody in the world knows this bird in the wild. And they said, don't search for this bird on the ground. Look on the trees, because it nests on the trees. And they were so lucky that a flock of birds flew in front of their car, and that is how they discovered in Rudarpur. Rudarpur now happens to be Udham Singh Nagar, the head block of Udham Singh Nagar, before, you know, 50, 60 kilometers down of, you know, Haldwani and Nainital. It is in the Tarai. People in Mumbai may not know for their sake, and people in South India may not know. It is the secretariat of the new state, Uttarakhand. Okay. And you know, Salim Ali, if everybody knows the handbook Birds of, you know, India and Pakistan by his author, co-author S.D. Ripley. And you know, they're just lovely, you know, when you see Hornbill's old Hornbill issues. On 75th birthday of Salim Ali. On 75th birthday of Salim Ali, S.D. Ripley wrote a poem on it. And you'll be surprised if you see four times he said Salim Ali was a Finn Baya fan, Finn Baya fan, Finn Baya fan on his 75th birthday. And this is on written in The Fall of Sparrow. Everybody can see it. In the journal it was published. And this is how his association with the bird was. And you know, when Salim Ali found the bird, it was an India endemic species. And 130 years later, in May 96, the bird was seen in Shukla Pata by another leading ornithologist of Nepal, Dr. Hemsagar Bagal. So our India endemic bird is now also seen in Nepal, 50 kilometers in Shukla Pata. Okay. And you know, I have to keep track of the time also. After 40 years of Salim Ali's, you know, research, I started serving in the same locations in 97. And this, you know, we started a project in 2016 and 17 in Meniches. And I'll tell you slightly, I didn't introduce myself. I am from Meerut. I live near a community of bird trappers. And near my bird community of trappers, there used to be a bird exporter also, Rahutar Chacha. And you know, I as a child played with the Finn Baya. Probably I have seen the maximum number of Finn Baya, even more than Salim Ali, when these birds were brought to India and they were from India, they were exported to many places. So I knew exactly the person used to bring these birds from Udham Singh Nagar. That was first thing. And you know, when I say they were exported, nobody will believe me. Everybody believes Tim and Skip. He has done a wonderful work. He used to sit at the Heathrow Airport. He used to examine shipments coming out of India. And he has documented Finn Baya coming to UK from India. That is one documentation. And he wrote that time also, where is the Finn Weaver coming? And this report is very nicely published, called All Heavens in Our Age. And I exactly knew these people. Okay. And I completed my master's in wildlife in 1994. And you know, 95, 96, there was Birds to Watch, and you know, Nigel Coller book, Birds to Watch. And we were all preparing for the threatened birds of Asia. And my teacher, Dr. Imani, was there. He said, you know this bird? I said, I know this bird. I've seen this bird. And you sometimes used to, you know, not believe me, and sometimes it's believe me. And I said, I've seen this bird. So So I collected all the existing information. And you know, one morning in June, it was end of June, I said, I want to see this bird. So that time there were landline, there were hardly any cell phones. I went to this person. And you know, I had around 300 rupees in my pocket. It was 60 rupees fare from Meerut to Rudrapur. I went to this person. And the only thing he asked, he says, will you put fuel in my in my scooter? I said, how much? He said, 50 rupees. And I stayed in a dharamshala of 10 rupees. I want to tell the youngsters, you know, if you have a will, you can find the bird. And I stayed in a dharamshala. It was 150 for travel and 50. And this fellow took me to the field. He showed me every place of Sinbaya. So I share the credit with this clan. They were, you know, from the fisherman origin clan called Mahagir. And they, you know, take, you know, bark ke kheke, like the fruiting of trees, and they do fishing. And they traveled to all these places of Udham Singh Nagar. So they kept a track on this bird. They used to bring it. And in 1989, the government of India banned the trade. So from 1889 till 96, 97, there was no information of this bird because birds started not coming in the trade. And, you know, this is how. And in 1 year, we did surveys. I nearly spent, you know, every year started I going to Rudrapur. And, you know, first time I went, I only saw the nest. In 1998, I saw nearly 200 birds and, you know, 200 nests and that kind of a stuff in that area. And this is the best season. Every year, the end of May and the June, first week of June, you see this bird. So it is extremely local, but extremely flamboyant and vocal during the nesting time when it is, you know, yellow. It is sold as a substitute of canary. That is the beauty of this bird. And as I said, my greatest strength was these people. You know, they had very much livelihood issues. The exporters are sitting, and if you see, all sort of people are there, and you know, livelihood issues. And you know, I have to deplore these people. Please tell me the location and these kind of things. That is how I find the bird. And as I told you in the beginning, coming to the morphology, the female of the fin weaver also acquires a distinct breeding plumage. What you can see in the picture is the breeding plumage. The tail is rounded, very heavily legged, long tail weaver, large bill. So this is different from all the other three beaver birds, okay? And this is what I created after 1901, the non-breeding plumage and the breeding plumage. This is a first year male, very beautiful, very bill is very, very big. And if you see, nature has, you know, its own law. They become so drab, and the grasses are so drab, they cannot be predated. And that is, you know, they become green when the grasses are there and these kind of things. Eh? And this is a adult male and adult female. So I hope, you know, anytime you are in the field in North India, anytime you are in Kaziranga, Manas, or you are near Corbett, you can look for these things. Okay. And this is in the non-breeding season. So can you see the contrast? The yellow and the non-yellow. So what 1866 specimens were non-yellow, then 1901 were yellow, and that was the differentiation. Now I'll slightly talk of the eastern subspecies. I'm sorry to say, even, you know, the highest books, because of so less information, if you can see the picture of Kolkata, it is an eastern bia. It was named as fin weaver. It also got published in, you know, Bengali books. And OBC has hosted this site and talked in the Handbook of Birds of the World also. But this is a wrong. Eastern subspecies picture almost resembles the Western subspecies. We have to really do genetics work, you know, to know either they are two subspecies. And just before the lockdown, Dr. Girish and I was there meeting the chief wildlife warden on 17th of March, that please allow us to trap two specimens to do genetic analysis, whether these two subspecies are different or the same. Okay. So subspecies, according to Salim Ali, has wide belly, and these information was totally, you know, cross-checked, and there were some disparities which were, you know, taken out. You know, we talk of habitats, and probably the Tarai is one of the most threatened habitat. The Tarai habitat harbors species like the swarm francolin. It harbors these species like Bengal furikan. It harbors the swarm deer. So that is the beauty of Tarai. There are Bombex ceiba or the silk cotton trees. There are grasses which are short. Deers forage on it. And it is one of the very neglected ecosystem. In India, you can see the Tarai grasslands in Dudhwa National Park. You can see in periphery of, you know, the Shukla Fata and bordering areas of Nepal and India. And you can see them in Manas and Kaziranga. These are some of the Tarai habitats. And this is the pure habitat which the fin bia spreads on. And, you know, as I said, it feeds on the grass seeds. The favorite food of this bird is the hemp. The onset of the breeding the onset of these the hemp seeds, and they you know, to see the bird, you first locate the hemp, you know, shrubs in that vicinity of the distribution, and you might be lucky to see it. And if you can see in the second picture, it is not eating, it is eating the grass seed, which was I was saying in the beginning. Very cunning bird. It will see a huge flock of munias, then go to that flock, chase away the munias, and it will exactly know where the grass seeds are there. And extremely fond of the termites. You know, they'll come and feed the chicks with the termites. So when you do a lot of research, you see all these. Okay, just to mention, I was talking of the three other weaver birds. And you know, there is so much ecological partitioning in the same habitat where all the four species are together. One prefers, you know, the sacrum, dry grasslands. The other prefers the dry scrublands. The third prefers, you know, tall wet grasslands, taipa, tatai grass. So even in the same areas, their habitat micro level preference is different. And you know, the common thing of all these, they attain a breeding plumage, the females don't. They all have a suspended hanging nest. And fin weaver does not have a suspended. This, you know, now micro habitat is missing. You know, palm trees are missing, shrubs are missing, you know, the prosopis and all. And you know, I have to rush that now that even, you know, nesting on the wires, telephone wires going, because they feel it is safe from crows and, you know, other factors. And you know, they have two different breeding seasons, May and September. Because of the time, I'll, you know, just mention just one thing. I have never seen the September breeding in the areas where Ambedkar Sahab and Salim Ali had seen and recorded the breeding in the tall wet grasslands. I have always seen them breeding, but Salim Ali had also seen them in Semal, Bombex Seba trees, called Semal trees, or the silk cotton trees. And you know, for the common birder, you know, the birds have a tendency to make a nest, hide and make a nest, safe from predators, from crows and, you know, things like this. You know, when I went and saw the nest for the first time, I became mad. I said, why this bird even, you know, cuts every leaf where they make the nest? And these is, you know, this is what we want to study. Why does it do that? How does it help the ecology of this bird? And they make nest on tall semal trees, sometimes very short. And, you know, this is multiple nests, you know, this. And then I came to know what I told you in the beginning, that Africa has got maximum number of weaver birds. And one day my daughter asked me a question, why, which is the commonest bird of the world? And I just thought it is the quila. It is a weaver bird found in Africa. Oh, then my thing came that this bird is most probably related to the African weaver birds, which are in millions. They were in the Tarai like machhars, like mosquitoes, what the old trappers used to tell me. Now the population is so small, even if they make nest on the trees, it just doesn't appear like a colony. It is, you know, just few nests. And I'll show you the pictures. And you know, it is a very clever bird. It will nest on the Bombex Seba trees because the Bombex Seba trunk has got spikes. So predators can't, you know, mammalian predators can't, you know, don't prefer this tree, short trees. And it will always select a tree with a black drongo. The black drongo is also called Kotwal in Hindi. Why it is called Kotwal or King Crow? Because it chases off predators which come to, you know, prey on the nestlings. And, you know, orioles, they nest on these trees. And this weaver bird, Salim Ali and, you know, Ambedkar wrote very small, minute observations for people like us to follow in the future. They wrote out of the 7 nesting sites, 5 of them have an active nest of a drongo. And this is also, you know, how they select the tree. They select the tree with the active drongo nest. And, you know, I told you in the beginning, they will pluck all the leaves. This is the first time, you know, within a week, they make the whole nest. And once they select the tree, they start plucking off the leaves. And this is how the nesting takes place. And these are my nesting colonies in 1998. There used to be so many. These were all black and white pictures. And, you know, we thought, as you know, scientists, we should take slides, and I never knew that I should preserve these slides, I should get them scanned. I never knew that in future the bird will become so endangered. And this is a picture I took. And what I was talking of, the quilas, you know, they can outshine an elephant. If you can see the picture on the right top, millions of them are together. So when we say, you know, bottleneck effect, the genes are so small that they can be, you know, fin weaver, the population has got so low that probably it will not revive to fight that big a number with predators. And this, you know, when I did my last surveys, I just saw around 8 or 9 nests in the best area where Salim Ali had seen 800 nests. And this is my 21 years of experience. It took me 3 days to find this. I was happy. I was filming this place. There were around, you can see 8 or 9 nests, 1 or 2 birds. I said, at least during my survey, I could get hold of a tree. And I started, you know, I have to, you know, cut short. And you know, I'll come again to the Kolji. When I started my surveys in 1998, I could see the development of Tarai in terms of, you know, infrastructure development for the coming, the secretariat of Uttarakhand. And if you can see, there is a nesting tree with 6-7 nests in 99, and you can see a water tank coming. This is the prime area. Now there is the secretariat of Uttarakhand over there, and there's a 5-star hotel Blue Lagoon standing on the place where the trees were there. If you can see at the back, you know, at the back, you can see 2 or 3 small Bombyxiba trees in the picture of the secretariat. They were the nesting colonies. And then bird life set because of the, you know, disappearance of colonies, cage bird trade and many things. Today, if you go to Nainital, you will cross over Udham Singh Nagar. It will be a very, very prosperous town. Many vehicular factories have come. Every area has now turned into, you know, state industrial development corporation. And, you know, you can see Pantnagar and all. Pantnagar has got a beautiful university where I have to stay. Every farmer is now doing 3 cropping of you know, rice. And they are from outside. They use the worst of pesticide to get the best of, you know, where will all these birds sustain. The best of milk come from all these dairies in the Tarai. So there's a huge population of livestock over there. On top of that, you can map, there's a tribe called Kalandar who are into breeding of ponies and, you know, mules and, you know, horses and all. And they know the best of grasslands in Uttarakhand and UP Tarai areas. If you can see the picture in the down, they collect the non-seeding grasses, which are very important for the fin weaver and other weaver birds and munias. And these are some of the areas. And, you know, the rehabilitation of the baksas, tharus and all, they still depend on the grasses. The onset of winter, monsoon is the collection of the grasses when they grow with the rains for the thatching. And that is a very, very stiff competition for the street weaver bird and the fin weaver to nest in the second nesting. And, you know, I was a fool. I stay in Meerut. I used to go to Hasnapur. Never realized Hasnapur used to have auctions of thousands of, you know, grasses for the cardboard industry. And I never knew all these grasses were the home of the weaver birds. And Hasnapur is called Hathipuram, the Mahabharata and all that area, you know, the Jain temples. And everybody was, you know, banking on the grasses without knowing that this was the biggest home of the fin weaver. Where my research, there was a YM Rai Saab, he published 35 kilometers from my hometown. They said he saw fin weaver over there. That was Hasnapur Wildlife Sanctuary. So this is how. And see, they need tall grasslands to breed. Can you see the Sadarji? Double the height of the grasslands. And these birds prefer these things. And if you see, everybody depends on grasses. Can you see the amount? And every grass is utilized by the weaver bird. This is all in the summer when they have to breed. The munias have to breed. The grass birds have to breed. The many species depend on these grasses. And, you know, I was talking of the Kalandar. And the ladies, they collect all these so-called grasses for the fodder, for the mules. This is a very stiff competition. Down you can see the grass harvest. We have no grassland policy in the country. We have to work. Dr. Rahmani used to speak on the busters, grasslands, and I speak for these. Unless we have a policy for these grasslands, many grasslands will disappear. I told you hemp in the beginning. I'm slightly rushing because of the time. It's okay. And it's just 10-15 minutes. You know, hemp collection is bhang. And, you know, there is, you know, Haridwar people go in the Finbia area for this, you know. Okay, so hemp is a very big thing for the weaver bird. Just like the nesting colonies, they were theka for bhangs, you know, collection, and it's again problem. And when you collect these hemp, the parthenium comes, which is not utilized by any bird. Hemp seeds are one of the best seeds for the birds, and stiff competition, you know, everywhere this is coming near the ponds, collection of parthenium auction. The auction of hemp seeds is a big problem. And, you know, alternative habitat is very dangerous. I told you Salim Ali Ambedkar saw them nesting in water, locked grasslands. Now I've seen these population in the Kalagar Se Canal. And moment the rain comes, moment the flooding comes, these gates are opened. And if there are nests in the taifa, there will be some bird. If you can see the hills, this is all Kalagarh. So birds are there, but unable to breed. They may be long-lived. They may live for 7-8 years. If they don't breed, the population will not increase. Monoculture plantation, earlier it was all tarai. Now it is all crop fields, all monoculture plantation of eucalyptus and, you know, all for you know, commercial wood, teak and all kind of things. So the bird doesn't get. Impact of bird trade is very much. People don't think this is big, but this is very big. I said one grassland, tall grass, wet wetland. If people come and harvest the weaver birds, they will, the whole population will go. And the biggest problem which I documented, which is the threat, is the predation by crows on nesting colonies. I showed you this picture in the beginning. I found it after many days of search. And what I saw, I'll tell you. This picture I took in 98, if you see on the top. These are house crows. You know, I was, you know, very happy. I was seeing this bird photographing. And around 9:30, a pair of crows came. They pulled out all the chicks. They ate all the eggs. And it was very hard. I took a picture. I tried to shoot these birds and came back home 98, 99. Okay, 98 or 99. And when I went after 20 years, I go every year. Can you see the house crows were in the jungle? There are more number of jungle crows than the fin weaver. Now, what I told you in the beginning, they were in millions. They could fight the predators. Now they can't fight the predators. Now there are so many crows because of the garbage, because of the human population. Even the jungle crow, which is in the jungle, started coming in the colonies. Now people say use drone. People say chase the crows. You shoot the crows. Animal activists will not allow me to even hunt the crows. Now, what is the priority? My fin weaver, which is less than 100 in UP, in Uttarakhand, or the crows, which are in millions. That is a separate issue. But how do I prevent the predation of chicks by the crows in the nesting? Can anybody tell me? Can anybody come with a solution? I will be more than happy to know the solution, because every time they breed, 20 years I've been watching. My colleague, she was doing a study in Orang. We had surveyed that area and she also saw a colony raided by crows. It is very natural selection. They are natural prey. But should we lose our species? Okay. Now, because of the time, I'll not go. Udham Singh Nagar, where I saw almost 200 nests, I told you 220 nests. I must officially say, in 2019, I saw no nesting, no bird. The best population of the world, where Salim Ali saw 800 nests, and the equal number of birds is extinct. So what are we doing to save it? Okay, nest count is there. These are all data. And Nepal, I believe, is so lucky. Their graph of birds every year is increasing. 50 kilometers across the road, Sharda, Mahakali, Shukla, Fata. All birds have moved. Oh, so will they survive there? Yes, probably they will survive. I must tell you, like the Green Munia, the world best population is in Mount Abu, which we should encash. Nepal government will encash the species. The whole world will come to see the species in Shukla Fata. The whole economics of Shukla Fata, Mahendranagar, will change because of this bird. And we did not do anything about this bird. So their population has become 200-300. I went to see this bird. I must tell you, Kaziranga, all parks are closed in the rain season. Their park is also closed. I went, I requested. They sent me on a motorcycle. We got stuck, anything. We just reached that place in 8 hours of walking. Okay, but can we do the same count in Kaziranga? Why can't we influence the forest officer? This is no less than a rhino. If you have so many rhinos, why don't we do aerial surveys in the rainy season for the nesting success in Kaziranga? This, you know, the group which is hearing should write to the authorities that every year we are losing the bird. This should be the outcome of the masses, the journalists, to sort of sign documents to, you know, to preserve our species. And I also happen to see, now people say why they are in Shukla Fata. Very simple answer. It is an unintentional baiting. They have two elephants at every camp. The elephants are fed 30 to 40 kgs of paddy. Like trappers used to bait these birds are baited in the elephant camps. Not intentionally, unintentionally. And they have lovely grasslands. They have lovely florican areas. They have so many Bengal floricans. They tag the birds. They have rhinos. They have any other thing. Now my question is, if Dudhwa has got Bengal florican, a very sacred bird of UP, and in Kaziranga, and in why doesn't Dudhwa have fin weaver? Where is the micro level habitat missing? So we working on the bustards. 30 years for the government to understand captive breeding of the bustards. How long will we take? And Salim Ali took 40 years to find the bird first time in the wild. And after 40 years and 20 years of data, I'm seeing going. It should be listed as critically endangered. And I tell you, I applied for funds. I had was called in Dubai to give a lecture, Abu Dhabi, and in the end, they declined. He said, this is not critically endangered. It is not endangered. So what do we wait for a species to go extinct? And who decides the fate of our endemic species that people in UK should make it critically endangered or endangered? It is totally our responsibility to list these species in the right category to get the right attention and get hundreds of people to talk of lesser known species. That is my thing. And Nepal, Tim Inskip, Carol Inskip, they came. Hemsagar Baral, they did the best of work and got it critically endangered. When I listed it, only one person commented and they said the population is stable. So I'm all alone. No, all of you are there. So many people are sharing me. They should all write. And I must just go through the less time. BirdLife had said 18 location. In 1 year, we happened to see, these are all prehistorical records or historical records. I must come to it. We got 47 locations because of the help of the trappers and 3 new locations we found during our 1 year survey. We are very happy. The bird is surviving in non-protected areas. I was told by officer, did you take permission? I said, sir, why do I need permission to work in non-protected areas? I'm a bird watcher. I am not going in an army area. I can carry binoculars. I can carry cameras. So this bird is now only out 47 locations, now only in 9. So even if we know 47 locations, they're not the true locations because only 9 places. Okay. So these are all the maps. I am going fast because you can download my report. You can see these 3 places now are Bhawanpur, Harebli and Haripura, which has less than 100 to 200 birds. This is 1 year of survey of the niches. West Bengal, the species is totally extinct. People in West Bengal should rise up to see this bird. Dr. Girish made a very big, nice map called the heat map potential distribution. The bird was probably in all areas of Tarai. Now what you see are the blue dots, and out of these blue dots, it is only in 9 places. Okay. And now coming to solutions, we have to have a good thing, more systematic. First of all, we should make it critically endangered. The world population is less than 1,000 birds, in India less than 500, and find crow solution to the crow predation. And I'm very happy. People say what we have doing. We've been publishing. The first article came in 1999 in OBC. Many birds it has come. The report has been released. It has been taken by the minister. I must give credit to the Forest Department of UP. They came first to said what you need to do. I said, you need to do captive breeding of this bird. He said, why captive breeding of this bird? I said, you tell me a solution. How will the chicks survive in the wild when they will not be predated? It is always luck. So the UP government has given us 15 lakh of rupees for 5 years. We have to raise money. And last year, this project came. We got permission in July. And we were all very hopeful that in April this year, we'll start the project. And, you know, there was a news that said April we'll start. And now because of the lockdown, we can't go and start. This good news is that we will be breeding this bird. We have got permission for 4 pairs of fin weaver, 2 pairs each of the common weaver bird, 30 kilometers to my hometown in Hasnapur Wildlife Sanctuary, which was the former range of all the 4 species of weaver birds. We want to involve the masses so they don't, you know, destroy the habitat. And we need all our people to support us. Thank you. This is last slide. Thanks for your patient listening. I think I'm on time. Okay. So the floor is open to questions. Dr. Girish, can you take over?
Rajat, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you very clear.
Yeah. There is a question from West Bengal. The guy is asking, sir, I'm from West Bengal. How will you suggest we save these birds?
Okay. I think I have been looking for a person in West Bengal to first arrange after the lockdown a meeting between the chief wildlife warden, between all the bird watchers of West Bengal. There are birds of Bengal in the group over there. And we must do the presentation in front of the people who matter. There's still chances of an invisible population around Baksa, Hashim Mara Air Force Base, and many of them. We have to make the people aware. We have to teach all the bird watchers of West Bengal to look for the species and the right species. I, because of the shortage of time, did not tell you. Eastern Baya looks like the fin weaver, and most of the records from West Bengal were of the Eastern Baya in the initial time, but then there were true records from some centuries of West Bengal. So we can take up over there. the ZSIS over there, they had a stall in Gujarat and I spoke with them. We have to tie up with the local NGOs to start searching for this bird. And June, end of May and first week of June is the best time. The seminar is, this webinar is on the best time. So you can download my report. You can share with all the bird watchers of West Bengal to start looking for the species. Okay.
Yeah, Rajat, there is one more question by Ashwit Shetty. He is asking how much time it takes to form a nest.
It takes less than a week. The nest, if there is a good grasslands around, it will take less than 3 days to make the whole nest. It all depends on the wet mud available over there, water over there, and the grasses over there. Any micro level factor is missing. The nest will be incomplete. They will be not taken up by the female. And you know, the party of the males will go to another area. So 3 to 6 days, 5 days. Okay.
Okay. So what I would suggest, we will now post this webinar on Facebook and okay. People can ask questions over there and we will reply to their questions.
Okay. But last, I want to say, Girish, when we open the category for revised global status, yeah. More and more Indian bird watcher should, you know, advocacy to get the species in the critically endangered. We can't lose the species. As you rightly said, every breeding season is important.
Yes. And
you can understand, I think people will understand. And they can download our report. You can share that PDF with everyone. Okay.
Yes. Okay. Nandakishore, shall we close down?
Yes, sir. Please conclude the session.
Okay, you can share my email with them. So anybody wants any question, anything they can, you know.
Yes, sir. We have a WhatsApp group. Sir, I will post your email ID. So people can directly ask you question through email.
Okay.
I think we conclude this session. And thank you very much, Rajat. And
no, I must thank you, everyone. Thank everyone for being there, for you, for being a wonderful host and giving me an opportunity. Okay. Stay safe. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah. You can post your questions on WhatsApp group and we will post it on Facebook. You can ask questions there as well. Thank you very much. Stay safe. Bye-bye. Good night.
Thank you.